Revolutionizing Design, How BIM is Changing the Game. In this video, I'm going to talk about how building information modeling and VDC, virtual design and construction in general, can really, really change the game for you and the design team by communicating a concept that I think will be absolutely revolutionary. So, do you want to know exactly where this will show up? Do you want to know why it's important and how it affects jobs? If you do, you've come to the right place. This is your video. Okay, so I'm going to tell you a quick little story. So Kate, the CEO of our company, recently read Built to Fail by Todd Zabel. And we've also on the heels of reading How Big Things Get Done. I've been talking about those books constantly in these videos, and I hope I'm not annoying anyone. They're great. You should read them. That's my call to action. Read these books. One of the big concepts from Built to Fail is that we don't design and then go attempt to build. We literally design a production system in attack plan, like I always talk about, where you have wagons, which is the intersection of time and space, but inside those wagons, you have work packages. You could have a tacked wagon with one work package, you could have multiple work packages in a tacked wagon, or you could actually take a work package and split it up along multiple or inside multiple tacked wagons. But the bottom line is, the work package is the central focus. The trade partner's ability to execute work inside a work package from zone to zone to zone to zone in a flow is key. And the idea is, like I said, instead of designing and then figuring out how to build, literally design that work package. How many people will be there? What is the overall duration? What are the resources that are needed? What is the zone size? What is the production rate? What materials do they need? Any other information they need to actually execute that work package is the way that we should look at construction and then literally design to it. So we're looking at it from the end to the front, or we're looking at design with the end in mind, right? Always designing to the work package. Building information modeling is key for that. Let me tell you one other quick little story, which is pretty fantastic. We were with Kate and Kevin and I, we were in Mexico with our lean tech team. That's where most of the people are. They're there in Guadalajara. And we were doing a planning boot camp. And we gave them an example, just like we do in the Super PM boot camps, and they built it out of popsicle sticks and foam and large prints, and it really looked quite fantastic. And they were designing the logistics and everything else. And I said to the team, I was like, you are not like the normal participant. You know tact, you know the systems, you know lean, you are very good with tech, you can take it a step above, okay? And I was like, I'm looking for something remarkable. So they planned the project, they did the logistics, they did the production plan, all of the normal stuff. But at every step of that plan, which was to simulate how to plan in design, they used building information modeling. They modeled the trailers. They modeled how the site logistics would go. They did a little 4D schedule for us. They modeled how the building would actually be put together. They actually did a simulation model of the building itself to get an idea. They referenced Google Earth. And Kate was like, oh my gosh, do all of our clients do this? And I was like, well, you know, sometimes in the industry, BIM takes a little bit of time. It's not widely implemented, even though it should be. It's not implemented as much as we would want. And she was like, well, Todd says in the book, Build to Fail, we have got to use building information modeling to create your maximum virtual product, to design and kit everything before you actually hit the work package. And she was like, I want it in the book. I want a video done about it. I want this to be happening right away and encourage the industry to head in this direction. And I was like, absolutely done. Not a problem. Here we go. That is the thrust behind this video. The other day, somebody asked me, I was on a live stream with a couple of other industry change makers, and they were talking about building information modeling. And we're looking at some of the things that were wrong with it. And my perspective, I was like, really what's wrong with it is we don't use it everywhere. We really, really, really need in every step of design and pre-construction and project planning to be utilizing building information modeling as a standard. It should be just as standard as submittals, just as standard as construction drawings. It's just a thing. So if we head in that direction, you will be able to see what you're about to build, how you're going to build it, see all the problems ahead of time, get it together, prepare the work, and have a beautiful experience in construction when you're installing the work package. So I'm going to give you 8 ideas right now that hopefully you can research, learn more about in pre-construction when you're partnering with the designers. If you ever want to learn more about these details, I recommend highly a course by the AGC. It's the CMBIM certification. I loved it. They have great reference material, great examples, and you can dive in. In fact, we'll put that in the description below. But here they are. Number one, obviously visualization. So when we're in the design phase, I know that probably all design teams right now are using building information modeling for visualization, at least for the exterior elevations, and to model the overall building. So for visualization, it's absolutely fantastic. But I will say design teams that are taking it even farther are modeling the spaces from a mock-up standpoint, doing virtual walkthroughs with clients and the end users and the builders so they know what it should look like, right? They're modeling certain intersections for complex details. I've seen that for architectural details and for structural details. Like one of my favorites is where you have 2 structural members, very, very heavy or dense rebar inside, and looking at how you could actually build it in the field and modeling that typically through Tekla. So visualization is absolutely key. Your designers might, this is really good. Your designers might already be using it, but ask for more. And when you come up to a problem or a decision that needs to be made, always ask, and I do mean always, always ask, can we model this so that we can see what's really going on in 3D. Number 2, collaboration. So this will be really helpful if you're not used to it. Like when you deal with programs like Revit that interface with a number of other applications, it's a parametric model, meaning if you update something in the 3D geometry or in this view, as long as you're not doing 2D annotation, it's parametric, it automatically updates everywhere else in the model. And so if you have your architectural designers in this model and your engineers in these other models, and they're all linked, right? You can see real-time updates for where things are, and the engineers can see where your architectural components are, your grid lines, your structure, so they can design their systems and vice versa. So the collaboration that it allows you to do inside parametric models is absolutely key. One of the biggest problems that we have in our industry is that these applications, and Autodesk is one of my favorites, whether you think it should be or not, but Autodesk is one of my favorites. Like you'll have the designer using Revit, and you'll have the engineers using the structural and the MEP versions of these packages, but they're not linked together and they're not actually linked to the trade models or being modeled in a way where it can be downloaded and used in the trade partner's specific application that they're using to spool out the model geometry. And so we have silo, 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 silo. We should literally be looking at how do we have an integrated parametric model here that is heading in the direction that the trade partners can use it as well, so that we have as little rework along the process as humanly possible. Number 3, clash detection. This is great. We typically do this after design is done, but there have been many projects that have been beautiful from a product standpoint when we were done, where we actually did clash detection throughout the design process, and it was just fantastic. And we ended up with something that everybody could use. Kind of like when you like and subscribe to this channel, beautiful interaction, you get all the videos, but it helps to spread the information and we come up with a wonderful end product. So clash detection is definitely one of those things that you should entertain, and not just do it in construction or after design, do it during design. Number 4, simulation and design, performance analysis, and code compliance. There are so many different applications that will do this and help you, not only with code compliance, but with energy performance and a structural analysis, right? I loved, one time I went to Purdue University and they were analyzing these models from a structural standpoint, and they can simulate earthquakes, high winds, the whole nine. If you have it in these wonderful softwares, you can literally make sure that you're analyzing every aspect that's available in today's market. Like I said, structural, energy design, there's many more that I'm not mentioning now, but using them for simulation is absolutely fantastic. So ask for it. You never know, it might be available. Number five, cost estimation, quantity takeoffs. We have softwares out there that can simply do quantity takeoffs all the way to full cost estimation. I'm not gonna get into the details. Again, you can take those courses through the AGC or through other trainings or through the specific applications, but don't forget about cost estimation and quantity takeoffs. And one thing I would encourage our entire industry to do is to make sure in the beginning of design that our models are more accurate so it can be used for that purpose. Number six, scheduling. We have a long way to go with this, but I do think we need to keep heading in that direction. We can right now do 4D schedules where we take the model geometry, we tie it to a location-based schedule, typically a tact plan, and really simulate how that building is going to come together, then look at how you're going to build it from a constructability standpoint, and then design tailored to construction. So this is fantastic. And you can use those same 4D models or 4D schedules to communicate to the rest of the team the overall plan. It's fantastic. Our industry does need to get better and faster at it, and softwares have a long way to go, but it's still an option, and I would ask you to please ask for it when the time is right. Number seven, obviously documentation. When you are using building information modeling in your design, you literally have a better plan set. It's parametric, it's tied together. Nobody likes the historical disconnected elevator details, right, from what's actually going to be installed. Nobody likes the 2D annotation that has to be interpreted with how the overall building goes together. The more and more we can use these parametric models with real-time updated information that distributes and prints our beautiful construction drawings and specs, the better off we're going to be. So obviously for documentation, building information modeling is key. And number eight, enhanced decision-making. When you have the parametric model with information, that's where you get the building information modeling aspect of it, that is doing the simulations, that is allowing you to visualize, that is allowing you to see the cost, that is allowing you to visualize the overall schedule, you're able to have better decision-making. And so you should tie this not just from a, hey, we can do this standpoint, but tie it to, hey, we as a team really need to make these key decisions, right? So we're going to use it for this purpose. So number eight is obviously using the model or building information modeling for decision-making. It's absolutely crucial. So these eight are just a glimpse of what you can do. But the purpose that Kate had when she asked me to do this video was get people's mindset towards the concept of designing to the work package, using these visual tools, and doing more and asking for more throughout. So I hope that this has expanded your mind, given you some ideas for some things that you can do so that you can take advantage of this wonderful technology. And I would like to ask you, please check out the AGC CMBIM certification. Please reach out to us if you ever need help. We have a VDC pod, which means a team of people at LeanTact and at Elevate that can help you with pretty much anything that you need help with. So if you need help, give us a call. I hope you've enjoyed this video. On we go.